Anyway, don't anybody use your imaginations. That'll get you in trouble. Thank you so much for being here this morning. We're going to start worship here in just a moment. But before we do, let me do my wife's commercials and just remind you what's going on. After morning worship, we do have our kids' church. Praying the Lord would bless that. Just as soon as worship's over this morning, I encourage you to come out and be a part of the morning worship for our kids' church worship portion of their service. Tonight's service at 6 o'clock. I encourage you to come out tonight at 6 o'clock for our evening services. And we're looking forward to a good time in the Lord. No prayer meeting this week because of the Thanksgiving holiday. We've got a lot of folks that are getting a lot of stuff done. Also, because of Thanksgiving holiday, our midweek Bible studies will be Tuesday night this week rather than Wednesday night. So everything's moved to Tuesday, same time, 7 o'clock, but we're moving it to Tuesday night. So I encourage you to come out Tuesday night for our Bible studies. Sheila Rutledge is collecting for the Christmas for the Bogart City Nursing Home. If you'd like to give her some money to go toward that, I know that would be greatly appreciated. She's trying to buy, she's buying them essentials, toiletries and things like that, stuff that they need. And so if you can help with that, I know that will be greatly appreciated. All right, that's the commercials. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask God to have his way in our service this morning. Also in needs of these folks here that are going through some stuff this time of the year. So remember them, if you will, as we pray. Pray for Joanne Coffey, who's suffering from strokes. We want to pray for her that the Lord would touch her. Continue to remember Ronnie Gilbert, who's dealing with esophageal cancer. Jeff Jr., this is Brenda Stone's nephew. He's at home, but he's still needing prayer. So remember him, if you will. Reagan Cup is recovering from her surgery. So continue to pray for Reagan, if you will, that the Lord would touch her and minister her. Continue to remember Kim, Sister Jeanette's daughter, that God would touch her. She's been dealing with some fluid buildup from these allergies and these her lung issues and stuff. So we're praying for Kim. Madison's friend, Caitlin, her dad, is everything about the same? He's been in and out of ICU. So remember him, if you will, that God would touch him. Continue to remember Kim Saunders, who's dealing with kidney failure. They're actually, from the last time I talked to Ronnie, he said that they were going to be doing some dialysis and stuff with her to try to help her. So remember Kim, if you will, that God would touch her. Mike McFarlane, want to continue to remember him. The last update I got with him was about a week ago, and they had given him just a couple of weeks to 3 weeks. But just continue to remember him, that the Lord would touch him and strengthen Angie and the family, that God would just minister to them. Continue to remember Tony Wall, who's undergoing chemo treatments. Also Shirley Goodson, who's dealing with COPD. Joyce Barnes is dealing with cancer. Miss Barber has surgery coming up for cancer, but we pray for healing for her, and we're praying when they go in, they don't find anything. So we continue to pray for her. Continue to remember a little Serenity in this situation that's going on with them, that God would just give them wisdom as they try to determine custody and who's going to have guardianship and all that with her. So remember her, if you will. Ginger has surgery scheduled for Tuesday. So remember Ginger, as she's undergoing another surgery. This is like her third surgery or something like that in the last year or so. And so she's really undergoing a lot right now physically. So we want to pray for her, that God would touch her and strengthen her. We just thank the Lord for what he's doing. I want you to remember one other thing, too, as we go through this holiday season. This is a tough time for folks that are have lost loved ones, especially in the last year. The holidays just kind of remind them of their loss. I know my family, my aunt and my cousins are really dealing with trying to figure out the emptiness that they're having to feel with my Uncle Lynn not being there. But I know God can fill those voids. God can fill those empty places. So I want to pray for them that the Lord would touch them and minister to them. Also, by special request, I want to thank you for praying for me for Thursday night. Man, the Lord really moved in that service. God really spoke to the folks that were there. I thank Josh and Stephanie and Tasha for coming, supporting, being able to be there. But I felt your prayers. The Lord really anointed me to do what I needed to do. And it was a right then word. And it really spoke to several people that were there. And I'm praying for the Lord to bring some unity amongst us in our churches. You know, we're able to connect with them. And the pastor and I got to spend a little bit of time before the service talking. And he said, you know, this shouldn't be unusual for us to come together. And for me, I'm very much longing to see not just denominational walls break down, but racial walls break down. I thank God that we're not one color in this church. I thank God that we got folks that have all kind of different backgrounds. And I'm thanking God that we ain't just come from backgrounds of one belief system. I mean, there's Baptist folks in here, and there's Pentecostal folks in here, and there's, you know, just different backgrounds, different beliefs, that God can pull the church together and we can come together and worship and glorify God. There's some of you been in church all your life. There's some of you, this is your first church experience. It's just beautiful how God brings his body together. Let me tell you, this is a little what heaven's going to look like. When we get there, I'm longing to get there. But until he comes, I'm going to worship with God's people, and I'm going to serve him. And I'm just praying that God would bring some unity amongst our churches. For those of you that know, there was a time that there were several pastors that we got together, and we prayed together, and we sought God's face together for revival in this community. And don't you know, the devil got in the middle of that, and next thing you know, people were getting mad at each other at a prayer meeting, and they were walking out mad, not coming back. And I'm, you know, and this was pastors. I'm just being honest with you, folks, over silly, stupid stuff, stuff that doesn't even matter. And so I'm praying for unity in this community, that God would just have his way. There's some things that I'm praying about. I want you to continue to pray about. We got some decisions that we got to make in the next few weeks, and I'll go ahead and announce this. The first Sunday in December, I know that we were talking about having a conference probably after the first of the year once we got through the holidays, but we're not going to be able to wait that long. We're going to have a conference on the first Sunday night of December, and we got some things we need to talk about. We got some stuff that I need to present to you that we need to make some decisions. There's some new information that's come up, some things that are happening, and we need to go ahead and move on those decisions now as to what we're going to do. I've already shared some of this with our men's council. Don't come ask me what it is, because I ain't going to tell you. I got more information I've got to gather. If I tell you stuff now, it's only going to be partial information. I'd rather be able to give you the whole. I got some meetings that are coming up that I got to meet with some different people and make some decisions. So if anything, you pray for wisdom. You pray for discernment. You pray for discretion, because a lot of this is riding on our future, where we go, what we do, and how we minister to folks. There are some great opportunities out there, and there's some doors that I feel like if God opens, that we could have more of an impact in this community. And that's always been my heart, is to make a difference in this community. And so we're just praying for whatever doors the Lord has, that he would open those. So we are the first Sunday. Put it on your calendar. Please make sure you're here. The first Sunday night of December, which is just 2 weeks from tonight, we're going to have a church conference, and we're going to talk about some of the things where we're at and what we've got going on. But, you know, between now and then, the Lord may come, and it won't matter. We'll have us a new home in glory with a paved sidewalk that's transparent gold and no leaky roofs, because everything he does is good. Anybody say amen? Thank you so much. Y'all done the switcheroo on me, but I'm all right with it. I'll catch you over on that side. All right. See, everybody that comes in a little bit late, they sit where they first can sit, and then the other ones, they have to kind of shift around. So we'll get all of it filled up before it's over with. Amen? Amen. If you would, let's stand, and we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask you to help me. We're doing a little things different, just a little bit different this morning. I've got a couple of folks that I've asked to do some specials this morning. Our youth are going to come and present to you a song, but we're going to open up with a song on the that everybody knows from the radio. Hopefully you'll know it. If you don't, you'll figure it out in the first few moments. But we're going to pray over these needs and requests. Yes, sir. Yeah, what was it? Ken, that's right. What's his last name? Said Lidke, Ken Lidke. Remember him, if you will. Malia's stepdad. He's got, if y'all didn't hear it, he's got a growth on his chin, and they got to do surgery for him at Baptist. Yes, sir, Brother Mike. Ray Simmons, dealing with a blood disorder. All right. Folks, the reason we spend time bringing these requests and these needs, and we're making them known, first of all, is scriptural. The scripture says that we should come before him. We should make our petitions, our requests known unto him. And with thanksgiving, we should come before him. You know, we don't come before him sad about these things because we know that God's able to move in these situations. We don't come before him downhearted and downtrodden because we know that God is faithful to hear and that God is faithful to answer. I don't come to him in despair like I'm talking to God like God doesn't know these things are going on. God knows what's happening. None of this stuff has caught him by surprise. He knows exactly what's transpiring. Some of this stuff I believe that God uses to bring people closer to him. Some of this stuff I believe God uses to get people's attention because maybe they've strayed away from where he is and what he has. Some of these things, as Jesus talked about, some of these things are just for the glory of God. Some of these things are just a means of taking people home to be with glory. Listen, you know, we pray to keep them, but we're all fighting to get to heaven. Sometimes you just got to say, God, I trust your will, and we're gonna submit it to your will. So every one of these needs, we're going to submit it to the will of God. If God decides to heal, then God's a healer, and we know God's a healer. If God decides to take somebody home, for them to live is Christ, but for them to die is gain. And we should rejoice with them. Amen? But listen, that doesn't change my mind about what I ask God to do because I know that God's able to do what I ask him to do. That God is faithful to do that which he's promised he would do. So pray, Pastor, if we're just leaving it up to God, why pray? Because that's what we're taught to do. We're taught to pray. We're taught to ask. We're taught to believe. And in doing so, God moves on our behalf. Sometimes it isn't the way that we ask him to do it, but it's still for his glory. And it's still for his glory, for your good. All these things work for the good of those that love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. He's a faithful God. Amen? Amen. So you may not know these names, but God knows who they are. We've called them out. We've made them known. And so together, let's call on Jesus and call on that name that's above every name, and ask God to have his way in this time of service and the needs of the requests of the people, these that have been mentioned. We're praying for God to do a work in them. So let's pray together. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for this opportunity once again that you've given us to come in your house. Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus, God, that you would move and minister in a powerful way. God, that you would speak into the lives of your people. Each and every person that's here today, God, I pray that you would help us to lead a little bit better, a little bit encouraged, God, stronger, God, in your presence, in your power. Father, we surrender all that we are and all that we desire to you, God. We desire to be, God, we give it to you in Jesus' name. Every need on our request list for Ray and for Ken, for these other needs that are represented across this room, God, we pray for healing and deliverance, I pray, in the name of Jesus. God, that you would save the lost, sanctify the unclean, and fill with the Holy Ghost. And with fire, God, cleanse us and purify us, God, sanctify us for your glory, I pray, in the name of Jesus. God, I pray for these that are in this room this morning. It's not by chance, it's not by coincidence that they've shown up in this place. I pray, God, that you would speak. God, speak and we'll listen. God, speak and we'll hear. But God, help us not to be hearers only, but doers of the word. God, that we would leave and be able to, as we're in this service this morning, God, that we would live our lives in a way that brings glory and honor to you. God, it's in you that we live and move and have our being. Father, we worship you today. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor for all these things. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, come on, God's people said, amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Let's worship together. Go ahead, Trace. The only name. Come on, you know this song. Yours will be the only name that matters to me. The only one whose favor I see. Come on, help me. The only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me. The only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that saved me. Mercy and grace, power that forgave me. And your love is all I've ever needed. Help me again. The only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. Yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Think about this. Wake up in the land of glory. With the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. La 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 la. Sing it, come on. Jesus, 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 just that name. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Oh, when I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Yeah, la la. Give the Lord a heck of a praise. Just let it play, Trace. Just let it play. Take a moment, shake a hand, hug necks. Welcome somebody to the house of the Lord. Just let it play again. Come on, welcome somebody to the house of the Lord. Come on, welcome to the house of God. Let's go. Yours is the name that saved me, mercy and grace, how that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. When wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Yeah, la 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 everything. Jesus. Come on, worship Him. Come on, sing. Jesus, just that name. One more time, sing it. Jesus, say it. Jesus, Jesus, just that name. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. When I wake up in the land of glory, with the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. Sing. Think about heaven. Hallelujah. La 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 la. One more time. La 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 la. Give them a hand clap of praise, would you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's good. Amen. Amen. You appreciate our young people? You can be seated. Worship with them as they bring your presentation at this time.
God is good. I just wanted to share a couple verses with you this morning that just I felt like God laid on my heart with this song. And just to share, it's from 2 Corinthians 4, and it's 6 through 11, I think, but I'm reading from the NIV version. It says, "For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made His light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to the death for Jesus' sake, so that His life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So we may go through things, you may be struck down, but you are not crushed." I love that verse because it says we may go through things, but we're going to get back up. We're going to be okay because God lives in us. If you belong to Him, He lives in you. And the last verse says that everything that we go through is for His glory. That means He's going to bring it to the good for you and for His glory. Worship with us as we work on this, as we dance to this song for Him. These girls have worked really hard for a couple months. And I'm so very proud of them. This may look, you know, this is our first thing that we've ever done together. And we work together putting the moves together. And we put it all together ourselves. So, and mainly them. And I'm so proud of them to watch them come together and work together. And this has really kind of let them grow and really connect with each other during this time. And I love these girls and I'm proud of them. So worship with us.
There's a wound that still reminds you of the fear, shame, and rejection you've seen. You've seen it. You know it's time to get up, but you
dreams you lost, they have found you. In a heart that once was beating, it's coming back alive, coming back alive. But something inside you can't deny. You hear the call of your creator. I made you for more, unlock the door. I wanna restore your glory. So rise, break in the dark, pierce in the night, you're made to shine. And we'll be at home, bringing the world already alive. Already alive. You are made to rise, rise, rise. Shut the door yesterday, to leave our heaven in the grave. You were made to rise, you were made to shine. Curse the glory for the dead, for kings and queens to take your place. You were made to rise, you were made to shine.
Great job, ladies. Worship with Sister Sue as she comes. It's time to sing. Tad, will you put my pulpit back for her?
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to worship you in all I do. I worship you in all I do. I worship you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. In all I do, you are my King. You are my King, Jesus. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free. Died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me,
You're a child of God. Like I said, you may go through some things, but you're going to come out. Praise Him because you're going to come out.
I am chosen.
The Lord. He's worthy. Amen. Do you believe Jesus is worthy today? Amen. Come on, give Him a hand clap of praise. Would you stand with me? Let's just do one more song together. I know that we've done a lot of singing, but just one more. Ask God to have His way in the service, but we just want to praise Him because He's worthy. Let's worship together. Are you thankful for the cross? Are you thankful for His nail-pierced hands? Come on, you know this song. Help me sing it.
Thank You for the cross, Lord. Thank You for the price You paid. Bearing all my sin and shame, in love You came and gave amazing. Thank You for this love, Lord. Thank You for the nail-pierced hands. Washed me in Your cleansing flow. Now all I know, Your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb. Son of God, the darling of heaven crucified. Worthy is the Lamb.
Stretch your hands up and just declare that. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for sending your Son to die for us and take our place. God, you're so worthy. Cannot thank you enough for the grace and the mercy, God, that you bestowed upon us. You've been so good to us, Jesus. We honor you in this house today. We praise your holy name, God. You've been so good to us. Bless your holy name. Bless your holy name. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen. Amen. Give him a hand clap of praise, would you? Praise the Lord. Our kids' church can be dismissed at this time, and while they're being dismissed, meet Miss Anna back there at the back. While they're being dismissed, if you'll turn with me to 1 Chronicles chapter 16. 1 Chronicles chapter 16. We're going to look at one verse of scripture this morning as a text. Just to be candid, just to be as honest and open with you as I can, I know that for the majority of the folks that are in here because of the holiday week, this may be the last opportunity I get to see you before the Thanksgiving holiday. But, I just wanted to share a message this morning that has culminated over this past week, not just because of the Thanksgiving holiday, but just some conversations that I've had with some folks that are a little more mature than I am, let me put it that way, a little bit older than I am, and just talking about this day and age that we're living in. The Bible says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples." Oh, give thanks to the Lord. call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. You know, when we praise him, when we worship him, especially in the company of saints, we're declaring not just glory and honor, but we're thankful for what he's done for us. We're declaring our thanksgiving to him. You know, I believe we're living in a day and age where people aren't thankful very much anymore. They're not appreciative. Matter of fact, there's a generation coming up right now, they almost approach life as if they deserve what they've got. They're not appreciative that somebody paid the price. They're not appreciative that somebody, you know, had to lay their life down or had to give their all or had to sacrifice their own wants, their own desires, that the next generation could have what they have. Man, I pray today before we leave this place that we're thankful. Not just for what Jesus has done, not just for what the Lord has done, but maybe those that went on before us, that our military, our grandmothers and grandfathers, our moms, our dads, those that really paid the price to help us get to where we are, those forefathers in the church that had to face the ridicule and go through the hardship, but to just leave this place and just say thank you. Maybe before you leave this room, there might be somebody that you need to wrap your arms around and just say, thank you. I know you prayed for me. I know you believed in me. I know you kept on keeping on. When I wanted to give up, you just wouldn't let go of me. Thank you. That's what this week is about. I'm thankful for Christmas, man. I'm thankful for Easter. I love those holidays. But this week is set aside just for us to recollect and just think back and just look over the goodness of God and his mercy, his grace, and say, thank you. He's been good to us, folks. I simply want to minister this morning on what it is to be thankful. Father, again, for the next few moments, help me. I'm your servant. I yield to you. This time is not my time. This day is not my day. This is the day that you've made, God. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I pray today, God, that you would help us for all that you do and all that you've done, God, to be thankful. Help us, God, to look around the room and see that we didn't get here by ourselves. I didn't make it to this place on my own. I'm thankful. I look across this room, God, and there's leaders and there's folks that have given and folks that have prayed and folks that have fasted and sought the Lord and helped me and stood by me. God, I'm thankful. God, I look in the back of this room and I see my wife back there and I'm so thankful. My kids, God, I know that they're away at school, but God, I'm thankful. You've been so good to me. I can't praise you for everybody else, but God, I can praise you for what you've done for me. God, my dad, what you did in him and where you brought him from and the healing that you performed in his body, God, I'm thankful. Thankful, God. Thankful that my Uncle Lynn come to know you as his Savior days before he passed. Now I believe he's in heaven, God, according to Scripture. I'm thankful. Thankful. So much, God, I could stand here and thank you for. There's an old song that says, I've got so much to thank you for, so much to give you praise. God, I've got so much. You've been so good, Lord. And we just thank you today. And I just ask you in the name of Jesus, for the next few moments, help us as we go through the Scriptures to leave this place with a thankful heart, an appreciation. Appreciation of others, appreciation of you. Appreciation of family and loved ones and even co-workers and boss people, God. Appreciation even of our enemies, God. Because, God, they are the ones that help shape us and mold us and make us to what we are today. I am what I am because of all those that either had a positive or a negative impact in my life, God, they made me and helped me to be what I am today. I thank you for that. I ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, as you're being seated, if you can mean it, tell your neighbor, I'm thankful for you. One of the most thankful writers in all of Scripture is David and Asaph and those that participated in the writing of the Psalms. We see in Psalm 105, verse 1, he said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. David was reiterating here this scripture that we used in the book of Chronicles. And he goes on and on throughout the Psalms, just reiterating all the time. Psalm 106, verse 1, he said, praise the Lord, oh, give thanks to the Lord for his good, for his mercy endures forever. In Psalm 107, he said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Verse 2, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. I'm thankful today. Psalm 118, verse 1, he said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Psalm 118 and 29, again, he said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. In Psalm 136, verses 1 through 3, he said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, to the God of gods, for his mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his mercy endures forever. All through this scripture, especially this last chapter that I was reading, every time that they would declare something, they would declare his mercy endures forever. They go all through the entire chapter about this, and they would say his mercy endures forever. Some people would say, why in the world would you keep repeating it? Because God is worthy of praise. Why in the world would you just keep going on and on and saying the same old thing over and over? Because God is worthy of praise. I'm telling you today, folks, you can just begin to say thank you now until Jesus comes, and you won't be able to utter enough thank yous for all the great things that God has done. I don't know about anybody else in this room, but I'm thankful today to be where I am, to be thankful for what I've gotten. I'm thankful for who he is in my life. I'm thankful today that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm thankful that I'm on my way to heaven. Why? Because his mercy endures forever. What a God. What a powerful God. What a loving God. As I quoted a moment ago, this is not my day, but this is his day. He said, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice. I will be thankful. I will be gracious. I will be appreciative of the fact that God has given me a day that I can come together with the family of God and I can worship him and praise him. You ought to be thankful that even though this building might feel like it's got its problems, but we got a house of worship that we can come in and freely worship the name of the Lord. I'm thankful today for the goodness of God. But the Bible tells us in this last day that that's not the way it's always, that it's not what it was going to be. We're living in a time of the last generation. We're living in a time where Paul was speaking to Timothy in the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. He said, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. Look what he says. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful. Listen, this is the age that we're living in. It's an unthankful age. Unholy. Keep going. Unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasures rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying his power. And he said, from such people, turn away. If I had time, I'd go through this list. I don't have time to go through the list. But if I had time, I'd take you through this list. And we could look at one by one of people that are in our lives, that are connected to us, that are living this kind of lifestyle. They're living this kind of lifestyle. And if I could sum it up like Paul did here, they have a form of godliness but no power. We're living in a day and age where everybody's a Christian, but they don't have any power. We're living in a day and age where everybody wants the label, but they have no power. We're living in a day and age where people are unthankful, they're unappreciative. And the scary part is, it's this younger generation that's coming up. Now, I'm not throwing stones at my young people that are here today, but I'll tell you something. I've been around some young people, young adults, that don't appreciate what they got. I was having a conversation with some, as I was sharing a little bit ago, I was having a conversation with some older folks with me this week. I was sitting in the car wash, and I got to talking to this elderly gentleman that was retired, and he was a retired truck driver. And so, you know, him and I, we struck up a conversation real quick, and he got to talking about these young guys out on the road today, and he got to talking about, you know, the money that they're making now, and what he had to scrap and scrape to get by with. He was talking with one truck driver, and the truck driver said that he makes anywhere from $40 to $60 an hour. I thought, man, I'm in the wrong business or the wrong company. Let me put it that way. $40 to $60 an hour. And then they get double and then triple overtime depending on what day they're working. You imagine making up to $120 an hour. But then they act like, that's what they deserve. Now, most of you know I own my own little business, got a couple of trucks that I run, and so I got people that work for me. And I'll tell you something, folks. Trying to hire people in this generation, they don't appreciate a good job. They don't appreciate a good boss man. I got one that works for me right now. And I've gone over and beyond and beyond. Listen, I treat him like a kid. I treat him like my son. Joel and I drove all the way to West Virginia just to pick him up because he's broke down. But when you talk to him on the phone, I'm like, hey, man, don't you like your job? Because you're at a point now, you might not have one. Preacher, you venting? Yeah. They're unthankful. I was talking with my mom this week, and she was talking about the two that she adopted and how unappreciative they are, and they're always taking advantage of people, and they don't want to do it. And it's just that generation. It's that mindset. I thank God for young people that say thank you. I thank God for young people that still say yes, sir, and yes, ma'am. I thank God for young people that still are very respectful to their elders and very respectful to the adults. I thank God for that. Listen, friend, there's times I have to call mine into correction because they kind of get that heady, high-minded kind of thinking. I say, whoa, 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 we're not playing that game. We're not going there. You better check yourself and get yourself in line, because I'm about to pop a cap in your head and you ain't gonna like what you're about to feel. Listen, friend, that's what my daddy used to do to me. Listen, my dad, listen, I'm telling you, if I didn't say yes, sir, yes, ma'am, I got popped in the back of the head. What you supposed to say, son? Yes, sir. I have people now, I'll say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, too. They say, you ain't got to talk to me like that. I say, yes, I do. I got a big old hand print in the back of my head that says I do. But that's the generation that we're living in. And listen, the thing about it is that we got a generation of people that are coming up in church that don't appreciate what people went through to get us to where we are, and then we throw them in the back door and pretend like that we made it on our own. That's why I love hanging around the Jims and the Helens and the adult and the Jeanettes and some of the senior adults in this room. That's why I like hanging around them, because, listen, I didn't get to where I am by myself. I'm not standing on a rock by myself. I'm standing on somebody's shoulders because I didn't get here by myself. And you ought to know beyond a shadow. You ought to be thankful for where you are and what you've got. I didn't make it by myself. You didn't make it by yourself. I got a mom and dad that I'm so thankful for. My heroes. Listen, I've sat down with Tracy. I've sat down with Christopher, and I'll call them out. It don't matter to me. They ain't got a lot of me, or they got a lot of me anyway. I'm their family, so anyway. But I've sat down with both of them, and I said, you don't remember it, but I do. I remember the little 12 by 50 mobile home. I remember sitting at the dinner table and telling my daddy I was still hungry, and he would take his plate and push it over to me for me to eat, and my dad would go without supper that night because he wanted to make sure I had food. I remember what it was when you had holes in your jeans and they weren't designer jeans. Come on, somebody. I remember what it was to wear them two sizes too small, and everybody laughed at you because you had high waters on. I remember what it was to wear Chuck Taylors before Chuck Taylors was famous. There used to be a day when you wore Chuck Taylors. No, you don't know what Chuck Taylors are. That's them high Converse shoes. But anyway, there used to be a day when you wore those, you got laughed at. Now they style. Used to be a day when you bought Pumas at the Walmart or the Voits with the Velcro strap. And you appreciated it. A few weeks ago, I was at the funeral, and my brother slash nephew, whatever he is, didn't have pants to wear. So I went and got a pair of my pants because he wears the same size I did. And I laid my pants beside him. He snuffed his nose at it. I don't wear stuff like that. I snatched my pants up. I said, you can go naked for all I care. You ain't wearing my clothes. Don't appreciate stuff. They're unthankful, but that's the generation that we're living in. And look what Paul defines it as. Paul said it's perilous times. It's perilous times that we're living in. It's ungodly times. It's unholy times that we're living in. People don't appreciate what people done and what people did for them and how they got to where they are. There's some of you sitting in here, and you make decent money. But I want to tell you something. There was people in your field, in the area that you work, that was a day that they barely scraped by to get what they got and do what they do. But they built up that business, and they did what they did to get you to the point that you could be able to provide for your family the way that you ought to go find somebody that's been working on your job 30 years and say, thank you. Thank you for doing what you did to help us to get to where we are. Thank you. I know it. Listen, some people might say, well, the boss man did it or the board of directors did it. No, friend. It's those people that worked at the bottom and they kept that company going. You ought to say thank you for doing what you did to help me to get to where I am today. No. We walk in the building like we own the place. This is perilous times we're living in, folks. What's this got to do with Thanksgiving? It's got a lot to do with Thanksgiving. It's got a lot to do with Thanksgiving because there has to be a shift in our thinking where we say to ourselves, you know what, God? I need to be more appreciative of those that went before me. I need to be more thankful for those that are before me. I need to be thankful for those. Listen, I'm telling you, friend, I get around retired ministers. I love being around retired ministers and still glean from what they did. Because, listen, I've got it easy as a minister. There was a day that they didn't have it so easy. There was a day, especially, listen, I've told you this before. There was a day in the Church of God. The Church of God was on the wrong side of the tracks. Now we're the premier church in the county. There used to be a day we got ridiculed and laughed at. There used to be a day that the old-time ministers would walk down the street and they would throw rotten tomatoes at them just because they believed in the fullness of the power of the Holy Ghost. Now it's glorified in commercials and everything else. Come on now. We didn't get where we are on our own. These are perilous times that we're living in. And we ought to be thankful to God for what God has done for us. We ought to be thankful how God has helped us to overcome. We ought to be thankful for God. Listen, Paul put it this way. 1 Corinthians 15:57. He said, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Guess what this was? He said at the end of all the things that he talked about. He talked about this corruption is going to put on incorruption. This mortal is going to be put on immortality. Death's going to be swallowed up in victory. The sting of death is going to be gone. And he said, listen, when all that's said and done, we're going to stand up and we're going to say thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, friend, I'm saved today, not because my mom and daddy went to church. I'm saved today, not because my grandpa and grandpa prayed, but I'm saved today because Jesus Christ hung on a bloody cross and paid a price that I could be saved. Listen, that's why I'm thankful today for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why I don't come to church half-hearted, because I didn't have a half-hearted God that went to a cross. Come on, somebody. That's why I don't come to church down and out, because I didn't have a down and out God. I had a Savior that bore his own cross and walked up that hill and laid himself down willingly, and they nailed him to that cross. He said, no man takes my life from me, but I lay it down myself. Listen, he's not some weak, feeble God. No, he was a strong God, even to the last breath when he declared it is finished. I'm telling you, church, that he declared it to be finished, and it's finished. Death is defeated, and we've been given the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. It's victory. It ain't victory just over death. It ain't victory just over the grave. But look what he said. Look what he said in 2 Corinthians 2:14. He said, now thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumph in Christ, and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Boy, I read that verse this morning. I got a little bit happy. I had to go back and read it about 3 times. So if I stay here just a little bit, I'm sorry. But this verse spoke to me. You see, sometimes when we go through stuff and we come out in victory, let me just say it this way. There's a smell that comes from us. Are you with me? What's the smell? It's the smell of victory. Everybody just take it in. Oh, that's the smell of victory right there. Some of you thought the devil done beat you up this week, but you in here this morning, and God's diffusing his grace and his mercy, the fragrance of his power through your life. Some of you thought the devil had you down, but God worked through you, and he made you a filter for his victory. He made you a filter for his triumph, and through you, he diffused the grace of his knowledge in every place. Now, for those of you that may not understand what a diffuse or a diffuser is, my wife's got a diffuser. My wife's got one in the bedroom, and some of y'all might have one of these things, but she can put about 2 or 3 drops of that essential oil in there, and before I know it, it spread through the whole room. I mean, what just looked like plop, plop, plop. Next thing you know, the whole room is filled with this fragrance. You see, what you're going through is a light, momentary affliction. Come on, somebody. but it's working for you a far more exceeding weight of glory. What you've gone through is just a couple of drops, but what God has used it for is that he's expanded it in your life, that it's diffusing for you the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. She's in children's church. Don't worry about her. So he's diffused his grace in your life. He's diffused it in every place. He's diffused it in every place. This is what God's leading you through. And he's causing you to triumph. He's causing you to walk in victory. He's causing you to walk in power. And what it is what that little thing that's coming on the inside is being diffused on the outside for all to see and all to smell of the fragrance of the victory of God. You see, when Jesus laid in that tomb for 3 days, I don't believe on that third day what got up was a stinky, stanky, nasty, smelly Savior. But what I think got up was the sweet rose of Sharon, that God brought him up out of that lily of the valley. God brought him up that bright morning star. I believe when that stone rolled away, there was no smell of death in that place. I believe there was no stench of dead body or dead flesh in that place. No, it was a resurrected body that come up with a great smell of diffusion. Listen, even though the devil might take you down, but when you come up, there'll be no smell of death on your life, but he's going to give you a sweet odor and fragrance in your soul, my God, for all to see and all to smell. Thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph. Oh, my God, always leads us in triumph. I'm not getting defeated. I'm not getting broke down. I'm going to victory. Woo! For some of us, it might feel like we're taking the long way, but the long way is still going to get you to the way, the truth, and the life. Some of you might feel like you're taking a detour, but I'm telling you, if God's leading you and every step is ordered of the Lord, even though you walk through a valley of the shadow of death, you won't have to fear any evil because God is with you. Listen, he always leads me into triumph. He always leads me to a place of victory. The Apostle Paul was in a great revival in Samaria. No, back up. The Apostle Philip was in a great revival in Samaria. And the Bible said that God was doing great outpourings, and the Holy Ghost spoke to him and said, I want you to go by way of desert. I want you to go by way of desert. In other words, where he thought he was going, there was a shortcut. But God said, I want you to go by way of desert. Why was he going by way of desert? Because out in the middle of the desert, out in the middle of a dry place, out in the middle of the heat of the moment, out in the middle of all that was a eunuch. A eunuch sitting out there. And when he came upon the chariot of the eunuch, the Bible said that he was reading from the book of Isaiah. And Philip went up to him and said, do you understand what you're reading? He said, how can I understand except somebody teach me? And the Bible said that Philip took him from where he was and led him to Jesus Christ. So here he was being led by God into a place of a desert. Some of us think when we get in a desert place that God has forsaken us. But that's a lie of the devil, friend. I don't care where you are. I don't care how deep you feel you're in it. I don't care how hot it is around you. I don't care how dry your life may seem. My son does. I'm telling you, God is right there with you. God will never leave you nor forsake you, but God's going to see you through if you'll just trust him. But right there in the place of a desert, the gospel went forth. And when the gospel went forth, that man stood up and he said, what must I do to be saved? What's restraining me from being baptized but a pool of water? But right there in the middle of a desert, God said, I provide a pool. They looked to the left and there was a pool of water, and he got down and he baptized him. And when he baptized him, when they come up out of the water, the Bible said that the Spirit of God called up Philip and he was found in his odors. What are you saying, preacher? Listen, this is the thing. The Bible said that this eunuch was the right-hand man of Candace, the queen of Egypt. So God, you're always causing me to lead in triumph. You're doing everything you do for the gospel. You're doing everything you're doing for my good. That's the word. All these things are working for my good. Always leading me into triumph. You're always leading me into victory. So God, what are you trying to do with me in this desert place? What are you trying to do with me in this dry place? You just don't know the very one that you come upon might be the one that opens up the avenue to the gospel to an entire nation. Because I'm going to tell you something. I believe after that experience, I don't believe no eunuch went and stood by the Candace the queen and stood there with his mouth closed. I believe he went back and said, oh, come and look what the Lord has done. Let me tell you what's happened in my life. Let me tell you what turned around in my heart. Let me tell you what God did for me in my desert place. Let me tell you what God's turned around for me. Let me tell you how God gave me a pool of water in the midst of a dry place. Let me tell you how God flooded in my soul. Let me tell you what God has washed away my sin. Let me tell you that I'm born again. Let me tell you I'm not the same I was when I left this place. Somebody ought to testify for the goodness of God and declare, God, I'm not what I was because you lead me to a place of triumph. Always leading me. And through all of that, you diffuse the fragrance of your knowledge in every place. Are you allowing him to lead you? Because see, if you're allowing him to lead you, when you get into certain places, people say, I sense something different in the room. Something's different in this room. Somebody say, well, you smelling corned beef and cabbage. No, you ain't. Something different in this room. Something different in this room. Oh, I'm country. I know what corned beef and cabbage is. Something different in this room. Somebody's walked through something in this room. God's brought somebody through something in this room. Somebody's got a victory in this room. Somebody's overcome a devil in this room. Somebody's been healed in this room. Somebody once was in sin, but they're saved in this room. There's something different about this room. There's a fragrance that's diffused of the knowledge that he is here. And they would anoint the Old Testament prophet. They would pour that oil upon their head, that fragrant oil. And it would stop at the top of their head and go all the way down to the skirt of their garments. And when they would walk in the room, people say, oh, they've been anointed. Something different about them. That's what God does for us, folks. He leads us to a place of triumph. He leads us to a place of victory that we can stand up and say, but thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. This is what he's doing in us. Not only does he give us victory over our enemies, not only does he give us victory over sin, but he'll even give us victory in our homes. He'll give us victory in paying our bills. He'll give us victory in our finances. Now there's some principles to it. Before I get to it, let me back up and give you the principles. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning with verse 6. He said, but this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let me stop there for just a moment. So if I, you mean preacher, you mean if I give, it'll be given back to me? That's the word of the Lord. You mean if I give, that God will give back to me, pressed down, shaken together, running up? You mean if I expend myself and give of my resources, that God's going to bless me? That's what he says. But he doesn't tell us to give and say, well, God, I'm giving because you got to do something about my bills. That ain't the way you give. God, I'm giving because I really want that new car. I'm giving, God, because the old truck's broke down and we got to do something different. So I'm going to give to you and see, wait on that new Chevrolet to pull in the driveway. Good luck with that. Good luck with that. The Bible said, give as you purpose in your heart, not grudgingly, not of necessity. Give because you love to give. You know, the happiest time of my week, it's not when I get my paycheck. It's what happens after I get my paycheck. The first thing I do, the first fruits of the fullness of the increase of my house, and I get to write that tithe check, and I get to give it unto the Lord. Boy, that's the happiest time of the week for me. Some people say, preacher, you don't talk about tithes much. Well, it's about time I start doing it. Huh? Have I got an amen corner here for my tithers? All right. See, I love giving. It's the happiest day of the week for me is when I write my tithe check. Why? Because I'm thankful for what I just received. And the first one I want to honor is not the power company or the water company, but the first one I want to honor is God Almighty, because I know that every good and perfect gift cometh from the Father above. Listen, I know that what I've got is because my God supplied all my need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. So I'm going to honor the Lord with the first fruits of all the increase of my house. Now I got, well, I basically was in my last meeting with the CPC board this past week, and I sat in that board, and we were able to look at our tithes, the monies that we'd raised, and income that had come. And boy, I love sitting in those board meetings and deciding who we're going to bless because we've been so blessed. I love doing that. I love, absolutely love saying, who else are we going to pour into as much as God has poured into us? And we purposed it in our heart. Listen, folks, when we in this meeting, when we look at the income, the next thing we discuss is the tithes. We don't discuss what we're going to pay this bill. And listen, we don't even have to discuss paying this bill or that bill. Am I right, Paula? We don't have to. Matter of fact, you know what we sat in this past Monday night? A debt-free building after 3 years. You know why? Because of the favor of God. I read a scripture today, and I can't remember exactly where I read it at, but I read a scripture this morning when I was doing some reading and studying. It talks about God's favor lasts for a lifetime. His favor ain't fair. And when you do things the way that He tells you to do it, man, there's a blessing that'll flow back to you that you can't even contain it, the scripture says. Come on, help me, somebody. I know this ain't good shouting message right here, this point right here, because I'm talking about your money. But listen, I'm telling you, if you'd release it back to God, I'm telling you, God loves a cheerful giver. Keep going. Let me get off of it because they're getting tired on me here. God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you having all sufficiency in all things. Look what He's saying. When you give, He said, I'm going to have you always have all sufficiency in all things. Why? That you may have an abundance for good work. Not an abundance for you, but an abundance for every good work. I'm blessed so that I can bless. And He said, I'm going to give you sufficiency in all things. Verse 9. He said, as it is written, He has dispersed abroad. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now may He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. Anybody like that word, multiply? I'm glad I don't serve an addition God. I serve a multiplication God. Matter of fact, my God works in exponents. I love math. I love it when God does things in exponential growth. In other words, He just keeps tacking a zero on the end. That's what an exponent does. It just puts another zero on the end. Anybody like to have an increase where you just get another zero on the end? See, y'all uncomfortable now because you're like, this preacher's going into prosperity. No, I'm talking about the favor of God. I'm talking about exponential growth, that you begin to see increase take place in your life. Why? Because you love God so much that you give to God. I'm thankful. I'm thankful. My daughters were raised up, and they knew what it was when Daddy had to struggle and work and carry on and do. And I still have to work and carry on and do. But anyway, my daughters, now that we've taken all this extra expense on, Kelsey, the other day, she was fretting over money and carrying on and going on, this, that, and the other. And I finally stopped her. I said, hush. She said, what, Daddy? I said, I don't want to hear it no more. She said, what do you mean? I said, is your car still running? You still got gas? She said, yeah. I said, you got a roof over your head? She said, yeah. I said, is your light bill paid and your water bill paid? She said, yes, sir. I said, is Mom and Daddy, they still got a house to live in and they still got their needs to supply? Yes. Does your mama taken care of? Can your mama go to the grocery store and buy groceries when she wants to? Yeah. You quit your whining. God's been good to us. I don't want to hear you talk this negative stuff anymore. God's been favorable to us. She said, yes, sir, I'm sorry. I ain't heard another word out of her since about it. Listen, that's what you got to do. You got to be thankful for what God has done in your life and say, God, I'm going to bless you and bless your kingdom and do the work you've called me to do. Now, listen, I don't want you to get sideways on me here about this. I'll be the first to stand up and tell you I'm blessed. I've been blessed. God's done good things for me. I ain't got no $50 rug and $25,000 toilet like some preachers do. I got a $100 toilet from Lowe's. Works just fine. Come on, somebody. I ain't got no rugs in my house because I got dogs in there, and we, dogs, rugs, those don't work good together. You know, I heard a preacher one time bragging about his $30,000 dog laying on his $50,000 rug. I thought, man, you got better things to do with yourself. Come on now. I take a $10 rug from the Habitat and put it on the floor and take the other money and bless the kingdom. He said, you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes what? Thanksgiving through us to God. Look what he's saying. When you bless somebody, when you pour out a blessing in somebody's life, you know, if I had a big old pocket full of $100 bills today and I started walking around the room handing out $100 bills, yeah, Sister Jeanette's already shouting, glory. Go ahead, Sister Jeanette. I got your attention now. But this is what this verse is saying. You might tell me thank you, but you say thank God. Some of you will be like, well, I appreciate that. But some of you, there might be $100 handed to you today, and it might be what pays your groceries this week. It might be what gets you gas in your car to get you to work the rest of the week. Come on, somebody, and you know what you're going to say? Thank you. You might even do it like that. Come on now. Some people say, why are you so excited over $100? You don't know. I'm broke, but thank you. Has he been good to you? Y'all ready for me to get off money? Yes. Doris said yes. All right. Keep going. I got more of this chapter. He said, well, the administration of this service not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also abounding through many thanksgivings to God. While through the proof of this ministry, they glorify God for the obedience of your confession to the gospel of Christ and for your liberal sharing with them and all men, and by their prayer for you who long for you because of the exceeding grace of God in you. Last verse, thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Has God ever done anything for you that you just couldn't put words to it and you're like, thank you, Lord? Has God ever just poured out something on you and you're like, man, I can't even begin to describe how good God's been to me. I can't begin to put it into English language how good he's poured out his love on me. I can't begin to tell you how much, where I come from. What I just can't. All I can say is thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Who supplies all my needs. Who heals all my diseases. Who forgives all my sins. Washes away all my iniquities. Who helps me pay my bills, who puts food in my cabinet, who puts gas in my truck, who helps me to have breath in my body to go and do, strength in my body to go and do what I need to do to supply for my family. Listen, folks, I'm thankful. I'm thankful this morning that I got a wife that put her arms around me and she hugged me real tight and said, I love you so much. Oh, I'm thankful. There's some people here or could be here that the only touch you're getting from your spouse is a slap upside the head. Some of you deserve it, Tim. I know Jeanette keeps you humble. Oh, Lord, Tim, don't come back tonight. Y'all know he's mad at me. But there's some things you just can't put in words. There's some things that God does, man, it just overwhelms you till you just stand there silent in his glory. And the only thing you can utter is thank you. God, this doesn't make sense to me. Why would you do this for me? Why would you love me so much? I want to tell you something. When he redeemed me after about the 30th time, anybody know what I'm talking about? Be honest with me. You ain't been saved all that time. There's sometimes God had to come and redeem you and save you all over again. When he redeemed me about the 30th time, all I could do is sit and say, I didn't deserve this. God, you didn't owe me a thing. I deserve hell. But oh, what a gift. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what love. Oh, what provision. Oh, what grace. Oh, what mercy. God, thank you for your indescribable gift. What a God. He said in 1 Chronicles 16, 34 through 36, He said, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. And say, save us, O God, of our salvation. Gather us together and deliver us from the Gentiles to give thanks to your holy name, to triumph in your praise. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel from everlasting to everlasting. All the people said, and praise the Lord. Go ahead and praise him. Go ahead and praise him. Why are they praising him? Because they said, God, you brought us and delivered us from our enemies. God, you're the one that protected us. God, you're the one that kept us. God, you're the one that healed us. God, you're the one that delivered us. God, the devil, if he'd had his way, he'd have took me out this week. But God, here I sit in your presence amongst your people. And all I can say is, thank you, Lord, because I made it. Lord, I'm here. The devil could have killed me, but I'm here. The disease could have took me out, but I'm here. I could have died in a car wreck, but God, I'm here. And all the people said, come on, all the people said, and they praise the Lord. Why? Because God has been good to you. God saw you through. God's made a way. And you ought to be thankful. You ought to be thankful. You ought to be thankful. Paul said in Romans chapter 1 verse 8. First I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you. For you all that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. Folks, I'm thankful for you. Come on, Tracy, say amen with me. I'm thankful for you. Can I be honest? You get on my nerves sometimes. I'm just being honest. But I'm thankful for you. Can I be transparent? You still going to love me after this? There's times when I look on my caller ID, I'm like, ugh. But I'm thankful for you. Preacher, you probably shouldn't share that. I'm about as honest as the day is long, folks. There's times I'm needing to call somebody myself. Come on now. And I guarantee you when they see my name on the call, they're like, there's somebody calling. I know they hear that phone. I know they don't walk by and went, oop. I know it. But I'm thankful for you. Come on now. He said, I thank God through Jesus Christ for all of you. Come, listen, you know what Paul's basically saying? He said, the reason I love you is because of what Jesus done in my life. If I didn't have Christ in my life, I wouldn't put up with some of you. You talking about me, preacher? Probably. Try not to look nobody in the eye. But through Jesus Christ, I'm thankful for you. The reason I love you so much and put up with you and long-suffering, the reason you put up with me is because of what Jesus has done in our lives. I'm thankful for that. If God can endure what he's endured with me in my life, there's people in my life right now that other people would have given up on a long time ago. I got people that work for me. People would have gave up on them. I got a buddy of mine that tells me all the time, why don't you just go and fire them? I can't give up on them. I don't look at it just as employee-employer relationship. I believe that God purposely puts people in my life. I believe that. I don't believe for a moment that people come into my life by chance or coincidence or just to do whatever they do. I believe everything that happens in my life, if I believe that God has a divine perfect will, if I believe that I've laid my life down as a living sacrifice to him, people that I come in contact with, there's a reason why they come in contact with my life. There's a reason why people walk in that door every Sunday. And I'm thankful. Why? Because I know what Jesus has done for me. And it helps me to be a better man, a better Christian, a better pastor, because I know how much he's put up with me and redeem me that 30-some times. If he keeps coming back to me time and time again, why wouldn't I keep going after people after all he's done for me? And that's what Paul said. He said, First of all, I want to tell you that I thank God through Jesus Christ for all of you that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. In other words, you didn't give up. You didn't quit. Listen, in the last 13 years, there's been a lot of people that quit on me. But I'm looking across this room at people that didn't quit. I'm thankful for you. I'm not throwing stones at anybody else. They had to do what they had to do. But you guys, those of you in this room, you've hung in there through the bad, the ugly, and the real ugly. And we're still here. I still feel the anointing. I still feel the freedom and the liberty of the Holy Ghost. I still feel His unction to preach the Word. I still feel His Spirit and His power. I still feel You love me when You put Your arms around me. I still feel the fact that God's still with us. He's not forsaking us. I still feel that God's opening doors and He's closing some doors. And for that, I can say, thank You. God's been good to me. God's brought me through. God's helped us all. And listen, we're here in the favor of God. He's not done yet. Can somebody say amen? Romans 6:17. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. God saved you. God brought you out of sin. You obeyed what God called you to do, and now you're delivered. You're set free. Some people forget what God's done for them. Some people forget how good God's been. Listen, this is what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5:18. He said, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Everything I'm thankful for. Psalm 34:1, David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I'm not quitting thanking the Lord. I'm not stopping praising Him. Ephesians 5:20, he said, give thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, even in the bad times, I'm still going to thank Him. Even in the valleys, I'm still going to thank Him. Even when things ain't working out the way they should, I'm still going to thank Him. He said in Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known to God. Listen, when you come to Him, just go ahead and thank Him. When you're asking Him to do something, just go ahead and thank Him. When it ain't working out the way you thought it would, just go ahead and thank Him. When the healing didn't come as quick as you thought it would, thank You. When the job offer didn't come, thank You. When the money didn't work out, thank You. Listen, you got to be able to thank in all things. Don't you be anxious for anything. Don't you get your nose bent out of shape. Don't get your mind all in a bewilderment. But you just say, thank You, Lord. I don't know why this ain't worked out the way it is, but Lord, I'm just going to go ahead and thank You. Kelsey and I were having a conversation this week, and she was sharing some stuff with me and how that she'd been praying and praying and praying, and nothing seemed to happen. I said, you know, babe, sometimes we need to be like old Garth Brooks said, thank God for unanswered prayers. Sometimes you got to say, thank You, Lord. Because I asked You that one in foolishness, and You knew the whole story. Thank You, Lord. You didn't answer that one. Anybody look back at a prayer you prayed, and you're like, whoo, I'm glad He didn't answer that one. Some of you are here looking, and you got a man's face or a woman's face, and you're like, whoo, thank You, Lord. What they come out to be, thank You, Jesus, for not answering that prayer. Oh, they were a glimmer in your eye, and you're like, whoo, Lord, I know this is the one for me, God. You just go ahead and open it up. Lord, I done got my wedding planned. I got my house laid out, the picket fence and everything. And then all of a sudden, you find out He's a scoundrel. You're like, whoo, thank You, Jesus, You didn't answer that prayer. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. God, I thank You that this is going to work out the way that You'd have me to do it. Last verse. Colossians 3:17, whatever you do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. In everything you do, give Him thanks. In everything you do, give Him thanks. We're going to take a moment to thank Him here for just a moment, but I got one song that the Lord laid on my heart. I've sang it once, I believe, here. But I want to sing this song, and it simply says, thank You. I want you to think about the words of this song as I sing it, and we're going to have an altar call. Worship with me. Do I say thank You, Lord, for the way that You love and the way that You come? For all that You've done and all that You do, my heart pours out thank You. You don't have to come. You always do. You show up in splendor and change the whole room. You don't have to come. You always do. You show up in splendor and change the whole room. How do I say thank you, Lord, for the life that you gave and the cross that you bore, for the love you poured out to ransom my soul. Think about it. My heart pours out this thankful song. You don't have to come. You always do. You show up in splendor. Change the whole room. You walk through all of my walls. Conquered my shame, stepped into my past, filled my world with grace. You didn't have to come, but you wanted to. You walked through all of my walls, conquered my shame, stepped into my past. Fill my world with grace. You didn't have to come, but you wanted to. You don't have to come. You always do. You show up in splendor. Change the whole room. There's a king in the room with fire in his eyes. There's a king in the room. Oh, how he loves you. You always do. You show up in splendor. Change the whole room. You don't have to come. Thank you, Lord. You always do. You show up in splendor. Lord, change this whole room. There's a king in the room. Jesus is in the room. Oh, lift your hands across the sanctuary. Praise the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, I'm so thankful, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, Jesus. Come on, praise Him. Come on, would you stand all across this room and lift your hands? If there's anything we talked about in this service today that you're thankful for, would you just go ahead and thank Him? Come on, be thankful to Him right now. Thank Him for your salvation. Thank Him for your healing. Thank Him for your touch. Come on, Lord. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Come on. This is what we're going to do right here. I'm not doing anything different. Thankful, Jesus. We don't thank him enough, church. We don't thank him enough. Come on. Show your appreciation to him. Come on. Show your appreciation to him. God, I'm so thankful. I'm thankful, God, disease came to my house, but you healed, God. I'm thankful, God, death came to my house, but you comforted me, God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm thankful, God, that you kept me in my right mind, God. I'm thankful. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. What a faithful God you've proven yourself to be, God. You've been so good to me. Lord, you conquered my shame. You conquered my guilt. You changed it all in my life, God. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, church. Somebody lift your voice and say, thank you. Come on, thank him. I praise your name, Jesus. Come on, thank him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Thank you, God, I'm on my way to heaven. Thank you for the cross. Thank you that the tomb is empty. Thank you that you resurrected, Lord, with healing in your wings. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for my family, God. Thank you for my job. Thank you for provision. God, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just keep thanking him. Come on. Keep thanking him. You don't have to come. Come on. You always do. Tell me that, Jesus. You show up in splendor. Thank you, Lord. You change the whole room. You walk through all of my walls. Conquered my shame, stepped into my path, filled my world with grace. You didn't have to come, but you wanted to. You walked through all of my walls, conquered my shame, stepped into my path. Fill my world with grace. You didn't have to come, but you wanted. You don't have to come. Thank you, Jesus. But you always do. You show up in splendor. Change the whole room. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Listen to me just a moment. I'm not trying to point anybody out. I'm not trying to bring attention to anybody. I just want you to think about this. I would say there's some in this room that you don't appreciate where you are. More specific, you don't appreciate the job you're on. It wears on you, it pushes you, it tries to make you quit, it tries to make you throw up the towel. I would submit to you today to change your way of thinking about it. And just begin to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for making a way. Thank you, Lord. You know, it might seem strange to say thank you for my enemies. Thank you for those that beat on me. But the scripture talks about iron sharpens iron. You know what they're doing in your life just might make you be better for the next opportunity. You know, in pastoring and ministry the last 25 years, if I didn't get any better, all the people that came against me, all the people that worked against me, all the people that spoke against me, they helped me to be more, they helped me to be better. They helped me to be a better person. I'm not going to lie to you. I wasn't always better. Sometimes I was bitter. But when I learned to be thankful, that helped me to be better. As long as I was harboring bitter, I would never be better, and I'd never get better because I couldn't stop long enough to say thank you. Joseph had to appreciate the pit. Joseph had to appreciate the prison, because if he didn't appreciate those places, he never would have been appreciative of the palace. He'd have never been able to stand before his brothers and say, you meant it for evil, but God used it for good. There's things in your life that will wear on you, that will rub you the wrong way. There's things in your life that will beat on you and try to push you down. There are things that you'll feel like is holding you captive and you're not living to your fullest potential. But while you're there, just say, thank you, Lord. If my steps are ordered by you, if these doors are open because you open them, then I'm going to say thank you. It might feel like a pit. It might feel like a prison. But God, if I can learn to appreciate this moment right now, then God, when I get to the palace, it'll mean that much more to me. I had friends growing up that their dads worked real hard and gave them everything. They didn't appreciate it. They abused it. They beat it up. I had one friend that had a real nice car, and he'd run it through the mud and just hot-dogging it and carrying on. And all I had was a beat-up 79 Chevrolet pickup. But I kept it washed. I kept it cleaned. I kept it vacuumed out. I worked hard on it because I knew my dad. My dad made me work for it. And I earned it, and I appreciated it. And I took care of it. I'm still that way about my stuff. My truck gets dirty, it drives me crazy. I want to get it washed and cleaned up because I worked hard for what I got. I don't like my stuff just being all tore up to pieces and messed up. But there are people that it just gets handed and they don't appreciate it. It's the same thing in life, folks. God is a good father, and every good and perfect gift comes from him. But he doesn't just dole them out because you won't appreciate them. Sometimes you got to walk through the valley. Sometimes you got to walk through the trial. When you come on the other side and you see the victory, you say, God, I thank you. And you're appreciative of it. So no matter where you are in life, no matter what lot in life you have, no matter what's going on in your life this week, the altar call is this: this week, learn to appreciate what you got. If you're saying to yourself, boy, I don't know how I got in this relationship, thank God for that husband. Thank God for that wife. If you don't know how in the world them kids get on your nerves, thank God for them. That boss man gets on your nerves when he walks away, don't say, ooh, I'd like to get him. Say, thank you, Jesus. Come on now. Then find your place and just stop for a few minutes and pray and say, Lord, you can be honest. I need your strength right now because my flesh is rising up, but I'm going to say thank you because this is helping me to be better. And I want to be better for his kingdom. I want to be better for his glory. Don't you? Amen. Father, thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your strength. As this song says, thank you for showing up when you do. You don't have to, but you always do. Thank you for conquering my shame. Thank you for conquering my guilt. Thank you for tearing down walls of my life. You didn't have to, but you did. And I'm so thankful. Bless your people today. Help us, God, if they're not able to be back for the service this week, Thanksgiving holiday. I understand. Family. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would help us all just to be thankful and appreciative. How good you've been to us. That every good and every perfect gift comes from you, God. God, I pray that you'd meet with us again tonight as we come back together at 6 o'clock. God, I pray that you'd help us and keep your hand on us throughout this day. Even as we get ready to go partake of this meal, I pray, God, that you would help us to be thankful. You've given us favor, God. and you've been faithful. I praise you, Lamb of God. I give you all the glory and the honor. Bless your people. Let your face shine upon them, God. Let your grace rest on them. God, keep them in your care. Lead them and guide them all to do. God, I pray that they go with you, and I pray these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Hey, find somebody in the sanctuary and tell them you're thankful for them. Love on them for just a moment.